The audiences want different things. They get bored.
And the thing about ska, too, it seems to revive itself every 10 years. There's a new generation of kids that are on ska, and they start dressing, you know, the white socks and the pork pie hats and everything, the checkers, you know. And ska comes around every 10 years, you know, like clockwork.
Ska can't go away.
My theory is the revivals are driven by whatever the decision makers of the record companies or the movie theaters or whatever they liked when they were 16, when they get in a position of power, they're usually like 45 to 50, so we get the stuff from 30 years ago because that was the stuff that was happening when they were 50 and they loved it. Wow, that sounds amazing. I'm gonna greenlight that project. Let's go with that one. That sounds, wow, it's just like the 80s, awesome.
Well, the 70s, I think, was kind of the peak of recording because it was still analog. It was still on, you know, 24-track 2-inch tape, and you had full ensembles, like full bands. You had the whole brass section, you had the whole drum section, the whole congo section, the whole drums, everything, right?
I think the peak might be 1962.
A lot of people say it's diminishing returns.
People were saying it was the Beatles too, with the four-piece band too, but I just think like having the whole choir and everything.
I'm recommending Modern Sounds in Country and Western Music, Volume 1 by Ray Charles. Mm-hmm. Recorded in 2 days,
right?
And he put the thing on, and the stereo imaging is such that you hear the kick drum if you want to hear the kick drums. The brass section's over here, the choir's over here. There's Ray sitting at the piano, and they had the beautiful rooms, awesome microphones, skilled engineers, skilled producers, skilled arrangers, skilled musicians, right down to the third sax player, or the fourth sax player, is an awesome guy. And the combination, and yeah, great. And a collection of killer songs. The combination of all that, you may not necessarily like that album. That's just kind of like a lodestar for me, though, because I think that the technology, I once attended a lecture by Bruce Sweetian, who's the guy that engineered Thriller and everything, but he said he started recording the Chicago Symphony in the 50s at Symphony Hall in Chicago. So, and I had some of those records. I loved those Red Seal records, the Chicago Symphony, Great Picture and Exhibition. I loved those records. So I went up to him and I said, those records sounded amazing. Like, how did you record those? And he said, we put up two mics in Symphony Hall. We put up two mics. Anyway, I'm sorry, I'm going on.
No, I like it. It's what I need.
I need all
it's
that
what I need. It's what I need. You're getting all that. My question now, before we go, we're done. We're probably done because we're all done. But is there any way you can tell Peter how to play that wild bass line and you can give a little piece before you go?
Sure.
Thank you. That's fine. When the song comes on, the last time it happened at the Horseshoe, I went ape shit, and I made them pull up the track, and the whole Horseshoe was going crazy.
That was an amazing night, you know.
Dude.
That was like, you know.
Dude.
Well,
that song messes up me. Thank you all for a nice, great conversation today. I could use a 10 more people, but this is good for me too.
Thank you for putting it together.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I can't.
together.
That was an experiment because I wanted to write a song with just two chords in it.
It's better than too many.
Yes, I.
Well, you know, like those old folk songs that Jamaicans worked on, many ingenious ways of giving variety to not much variety. Many ingenious ways of doing it. Quite impressive.
When I used to use my guitars, I would tell a sardine can, a piece of stick, an electrical wire. I've watched people play this as a youth. So,
sure.
Thank you, people. See you, Louis.
Thanks,
Louis. I'm ready with this thing.